Iran has managed to manipulate public opinion here in the West and create the circumstances under which it has gone on doing what it's doing inside, and it has created this sense of the world community not knowing what to do about this. We have all, since at least 1996, which is when President Khatami became president in Iran, which is at least 16 years ago, and that was the time when the notion of reform in Iran was introduced to all the rest of us, that Khatami came to power as a reformist president, and we all somehow felt the excitement of Iran undergoing major change, and that he was the reform president, things were going to drastically transform. And then he took office in 1997, eventually, and came with this idea to office that Iran was ready for change and a dialogue of civilizations was what he was going to bring. From that moment forward, we have all, in the West at least, have come to this notion that Iran is made up of, the leadership in Iran for a very long time was made up of a reformist faction represented by Khatami and a hardline faction represented by various characters who kind of changed shape from the beginning, but primarily the supreme leader and later on the revolutionary guards and so on and so forth. My argument is that I think that this bifurcation, this sort of division, the rift that we all believed existed in the Iranian leadership was in part a product of the Iranian media campaign, public opinion campaign, to make us believe that whatever it was that was working was because one faction was winning over the other, and whenever there was a stumbling block in achieving what it was that we needed to achieve, it was because the hardline faction had gotten in the way. So Iran, in essence, had managed to successfully set up a situation of good cop, bad cop. You know, the good cops really wanted to do it, but the bad cops didn't allow it. I would like to argue that I think the majority of us in the West, including the American administration, took that as a fact and consistently tried to approach the reformists, the good elements, to create channels of communication with the reformist movements. All of these, in the final analysis, not only created setbacks within Iran, because every one of these misguided views on what the true nature of the leadership was, not only created setbacks inside Iran, but it also created numerous setbacks on the part of the international community in forging true enlightened policy on Iran, including a nuclear policy, including how it is that we're going to go about solving this problem. What is probably the most significant, or at least I would identify it as such, contributing factor to why we are here today, and I call that a lack of continuity in the American foreign policy toward Iran. That from 1979, when President Jimmy Carter took power, was in power, and had to deal with this new regime, which came to power in February of 1979, until today, there has not been a passing on of information, knowledge, and insight about Iran from one administration to the next. It didn't have to be just, a kind of conflict between the Republican administration or the Democratic administration, but there was no passing on of information, even from the party itself. In other words, one Democratic administration didn't pass on its knowledge and understanding of the situation of Iran to the next administration. In the case of the most particular, most recent example, it would be how the Clinton administration's serious second-term efforts on behalf of bettering relations with Iran never got passed on to the Obama administration, to the point when the Obama administration took office, it had every intention of doing everything in its power to do precisely what Clinton's had done and failed.